Hey guys, this is Spaulding here from the German Duel Masters community, and today I'm bringing you the top 10 nature cards from the Duel Masters TCG. And again, a quick reminder, we had two criteria when we went through the through all the nature cards and put them on the list. First criteria is that the card is really generic, really flexible, and has a really, really good effect. So you probably play it in almost any deck that plays the necessary mana colors, in this case nature. Or the second criteria, the effect of the card is just so broken or just so powerful, even if it costs a high amount of mana or is conditional, that it usually sets you up in a winning position or catches you up when you are behind, and even might win you the game like on the spot or in the next couple of turns. So a card which you build your whole deck around. So with that introduction, let's jump right into it. And number 10 is Fortress Shell. Fortress Shell is a really powerful card, and rightfully it costs 9 mana, but still it doesn't hinder you to play around this card in a mana burn deck, for example. Or like the only deck which you played is mana burn, and this card is one of the reasons mana burn exists in the first place. And you usually ramp up into your with your other nature cards and either get to 9 mana and cast Fortress Shell, or get to 8 mana and soul swap it out. And it immediately burns 2 cards from your opponent, and you are the one who is choosing the cards. So sometimes you can screw the opponent of a mana color. And in other cards that burn mana sources or bounce mana sources, sometimes the opponent can choose, but of course that is really nice, especially when you play against something like 4 color decks, to straight up mana screw them when you firstly play them, the Fortress Shell. And of course, by just replaying it multiple copies, or replaying the same copy with a soul swap, gives you a really nice advantage and locks your opponent out of the game, so you can finish the game in the next couple of turns. Number 9, Bliss Totem. And this card is quite conditional, because you have to have at least some cards in your graveyard to use its effect profitably. But it's a really huge boost when you get to use its tap ability, and it's one of the key cards in Mana Bonanza decks. And it has a really nice combo in getting back some cards from your graveyard to your mana zone, and then bouncing them back with Mystic Dreamscape or other cards like Threshcaller, like Belix. And boosting 3 mana, maybe on turn 6 when you play some spells early on, which get to the graveyard, can be really, really nice. So really good card, really gets you to your 9 mana, for example, to play Fortress Shell or Bonanza. And speaking of Bonanza, it's the next card on the list. Again, it's usually used in only one deck, but it's the name-giving card. And if you resolve a Mana Bonanza, you have like at least 16 mana. And with cards like I said, Mystic Dreamscape and Threshcaller, you can choose one out of your, or even up to 3 out of your 16 cards in your mana zone. And it's just like you play 3 Crystal Memories together. Mana Bonanza is just so huge. It wins you the game if you resolve it against Mana Burn, for example, on the spot. But against other control decks, it's really hard for them to keep up with the advantage this card or the following cards which follow up to Mana Bonanza gives you. And yeah, just a really strong card, and a whole deck is built around it. Number 7, we have two cards, and these cards are mostly or only seen in Rush decks, at least competitively, but these cards are so strong in coming out in turn 1, and even being 2k, attacking over other 1k creatures, which is huge, and of course trading with 2k creatures like Aqua Hookers, is just so good for only one mana. Of course they have a negative effect when you get 2k for one mana, but sometimes you even want the effect in the case of Sniper Mosquito, because usually you in Rush you only need 3 mana, so you can play your third mana, for example, play out a speed attacker, attack with Mosquito and get another card back from your mana zone to play in the next turn. So really, really nice effect in the case of Sniper Mosquito. Yeah, in Polygon, yeah, it gets bounced back. You have to replay it and have to wait a turn again to attack. So, quite a huge amount of tempo loss. But breaking a shield like with 1k, as I said, is really huge in these kinds of decks. And these two cards really enable the rush strategy to exist, at least in Fire Nature. If these two one drops didn't exist, maybe the rush deck of choice would be Firelight. But yeah, these two exist, so really huge boost for the deck. Next up, we have Cryptic Totem, and yeah, this card is comparable to something like Balmedius or Bloom Urcus. That your opponent just can't use the shield trigger ability of his shields. There's even an OCG version which is even more busted. The TCG version is a bit nerfed because this creature has to be tapped to use this ability, and in the OCG version that creature doesn't even have to be tapped. So yeah, really nice there. But of course, with Cryptic Totem being a double breaker, you want to attack with him, and it puts really a huge amount of pressure to on your opponent to either answer this card or answer your other creatures on board, and yeah, can really end the game like on the spot if you have like 4 other creatures that can attack. Sometimes you can just attack with a couple of creatures early, and then just the alone existence of Cryptic Totem, for example, if your opponent has only 2 or 3 shields, puts such a huge amount of pressure on the opponent, and they have to answer the game or the Cryptic Totem, or they will most likely lose on the next turn. Next card, Quixotic Hero, and being on number 5 is not quite up in the front, but also not quite in the back. It's in the middle, and I think this card is not only huge for Rush, but also all kinds of aggro strategies. And every aggro strategy that plays Nature plays this card, or sometimes you even want to play Nature strictly for this card. Again, the race of this card being Beastwork is also really nice, probably the best race for Nature here. And yeah, sometimes this card can get up to 7k, even 10k power, and yeah, it's really hard for your opponent to answer it early. Same goes for Gaunta. Of course, Gaunta is a bit stronger in not being able to be hit by Phantom Dragon Flames, Crimson Hammer, Volcano Charger, and so on. But with Quixotic Hero, if you don't have the early fire kill spells, sometimes you have to think, if you want to play a creature, then you, of course, you can't kill Quixotic, or if you just don't play a creature and kill it with a creature on board, but then you just waste a turn by not playing a creature out, and this gives aggro the opportunity to pull ahead even further. And yeah, as I said, the attack power can get up really, really high, and can even go over something like Azirnios, for example, especially if it also gets boosted by Petrova, and mostly you use Light Nature together, so you will use one or two Petrovas in your deck anyway. So really, really nice card for only two mana. Next up, we have the Creature Searchers in the Nature Civilization, and most prominently there are these three cards, and of course there's more. For example, Camellia is another card for 4 mana, which says if you tap it, you can search a creature out of your deck, but these are the cards which you will see the most. Of course, Dimension Gate, being a shield dragon, only 3 mana, sometimes conflicts with the other cards which you want to play on turn 3, for example Bronze Arm Tribe, especially in the Nature Civilization, but in all kinds of spell-based decks, for example in Phorbos of Fire Control, this card is being played over your Terror Horn, because it can be searched and it doesn't conflict in this deck, at least, with your other turn 5 plays like Sky Sword or even Fall, and so on. And Terrorhorn is seen in also aggro decks, but also midrange decks, and just putting a buddy, a 3k buddy, is huge in being able to trade profitably against other 2k cards like Aquahulkus, like Coral, and other stuff. And yeah, getting a creature out of your deck which you can play immediately on the next turn, yeah, really, really nice, and is like a pseudo draw in the nature section, and is your advantage giving card in the nature section, because you play a creature and get a creature back out of your deck, and you go plus 1 with this card. In Dimension Gate, you go plus 0 because you use a card and get a card, and in Terrorhorn you get plus 1, you get a buddy, and you get a creature out of your deck. And for Factory Shell, yeah, this is like, without this card, Survivor, or the Survivor deck would not be played, I guess, or at least will be much, much worse than it is now. Just together with Grave Worm, the two most iconic cards, I guess, in the Survivor race, in the Survivor deck. And being able to search any Survivor out of your deck, even another Factory Shell, hedges you against some kind of removal from your opponent. So, yeah, getting the card you need out of your deck is in sometimes. Sometimes most, sometimes even better than, for example, if you play an energy stream, yeah, you spend only 3 mana and get plus 1, but you get 2 random cards to your hand, and with playing Terrorhorn or Factory Shell, you get exactly the card you want for the exact situation you are in. So, yeah, sometimes the additional mana cost is worth it to play these cards in favor of other draw effects in the water section. So coming up to number 3 is Ark, and yeah, this card is just so powerful in just being there, in just existing. So your opponent will always have to ask themselves if you play, do you play Ark or do you not play Ark? Can I handle an Ark on turn 4, for example, if I play Cranium Clamp or not? And most of the time the answer is no, I cannot handle an Ark, and they have to charge their darkness discard spells, at least the ones where you choose what to discard, just so they can play around this card. And yeah, sometimes if your opponent well, didn't see this card in just like the first rounds or just the first two games, and being a best of three, and in a third game they think, well, you didn't play it all the game, all the games before, you just and then in this case you just have it in your hand, and this card coming out is just such a blowout for your opponent. And being able to double break like instantly is just so huge and so strong. And yeah, being an Earth Dragon also helps in some kind of yeah, fun builds with Bejula. And there is even a nice synergy between Emergency Typhoon and discard. When your opponent is breaking into your shields and hitting Emergency Typhoon, you draw two and discard your arc, and of course it's still your opponent's turn because you have used your shield trigger ability from your Typhoon, and then you can instantly play this card even if your opponent is not playing any darkness cards in your deck, so keep that in mind too. And yeah, just really powerful. So number two is Brassam Tribe, and yeah, I think the cards in the third, in the second, and in the first place were not debatable. They were just pretty much set in stone, and Brassam Tribe is yeah, probably one of the most iconic cards. It existed for a very long, well, it exists for a very long time because it came out in the base set, the first set of Duel Masters, and comparable to Aqua Hulkus in that case. And just being a buddy and getting a card into your mana zone from the top of your deck is so huge. And yeah, just, I think you all know what this card does. And again, being a beast folk is the best race in the nature section. Just, yeah, not much to talk about this card, just really, really good for your turn 3 play. Then for the honorable mentions, we have three cards. We have Pinsir Scarab, Essence Elf, and Brutal Charge. Pinsir Scarab is a really neat card in aggro decks, because usually you want to attack early with your aggro decks, and giving your opponents hand cards in this case is profitably for you, because Pinsir Scarab will easily get over 6k, and being like with your opponent having three cards in hand, being a 7k double breaker for only 4 mana is really, really nice. And being 4 mana, there are not a lot of cards for aggro that you want to play on turn 4. You have all your Hulkus and Brassam Tribes, and which you play on turn 3, and all your Quixotics and Melnias and Emeralds and whatever, which you play on turn 2. But on the 4 mana spot, there isn't that much competition, so Pinsir Scarab is a really nice slot here. Essence Elf, of course, in any kind of control deck that plays a huge number of spells, is really, really nice. And this card alone also makes Fairy Life and other stuff viable, and of course together with Chargers, this card is really huge. And yeah, just cost reduction in general is just really good in any TCG or in any card game. And Brutal Charge is another of these creature search cards, but it isn't quite on the level like Dimension Gate, Terrorhorn, or Factory Shell. That's why we put it here, because Brutal Charge forces you to attack into your opponent's shields, and you will at least get one creature, because if the first shield is something like an Holy Aura or another shield trigger, then of course you won't get to search your deck for more creatures than one. And also the disadvantage here is that you can't play the creature on the same turn, because you are in your attack step, and after attacking you have to pass, and can play the creatures that you searched only in the next turn. But again, only 2 mana, especially in aggro decks which don't usually have a high number of mana, and if they play something like Terrorhorn, they will usually not be able to cast the creature, because, yeah, as I said, they won't have that much mana. So yeah, really nice addition here too. And yeah, for the first card, the best card in the Nature Civilization, if you haven't already figured it out, it's Soul Swap. And as I said, there was no arguing what the best card would be in at least the German YouTube channel guys. Soul Swap is just like the most flexible card in the game. You can use it offensively, you can use it defensively, you can it's a shield trigger too, so yeah, you can remove an opponent's blocker and attack for game. You can yeah, remove an opponent's high value creature like Bulmedios for something like a Bloody Skeeter, but this card is usually used for your own creatures, and just again, cheating on mana is so huge in any card game, and just be able to swap out a Fortress Shell for only 3 mana, or essentially only 2 mana, because you can tap 3 mana, and in this 3 mana there is the Fortress Shell. You play Soul Swap, you put a creature from your battle zone into your mana zone, and it will enter untapped, of course. Only if it's a multi-civilization card, then of course it will not be it will not enter untapped, but yeah, usually it will enter untapped, and you swap your tap Fortress Shell out, so you essentially have only spent 2 mana for this card, so even more busted here. And yeah, so just such a huge variety in this card, and in this usage of this card. And yeah, I think you guys all know what this card does, what you all have played against it, you have all played with it, and yeah, just broken, cheating on mana, as I said, really huge. And yeah, that's it for the top 10 nature cards. I hope you guys liked it, and if you agree, or even if you, especially if you don't agree, please leave a comment in what you think should be also on the list. And yeah, have a nice day.